A very good evening, everyone. I, Neha Arora Chawla, on behalf of Geeta Ratan International Business School, take this opportunity to welcome you all on the virtual platform for Management Development Program on Finance and Accounting for Business Managers. So welcome you all on day two. Geeta Ratan International Business School was established in the year 2004. It is affiliated to Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University, Delhi, and is approved by All India Council for Technical Education, Ministry of HRD, Government of India for Technical Courses, and Bar Council of India for Law Courses. Finance is a common language of business. By developing basic finance skills, you can understand how your actions impact your organization's finances. To better understand such skills, I would like to invite Dr. Vikas Gupta. He is a doctorate in Commerce and Business Administration from CCS University, Meerut. He is a member of ICI Delhi. He has over 20 years of experience in academics. His interest areas is finance and accounts, and presently he is an associate professor at Geeta Ratan International Business School, Delhi. He has presented and published various research papers in national and international conferences and journals. Under his guidance, two PhDs have already been awarded, and also he has chaired various technical sessions. In past, he has conducted management development programs on finance for non-finance executives for various industries. We welcome you, sir. I would request you to please take the session forward. Sir, you're not audible.
Is it okay?
Yes. Yes, sir. Sir.
Okay.
Better.
So, thank you, ma'am. Last day, we started with the basics of accounting, different sources of financial statement we discussed, then analysis part with the help of tools and techniques we discussed. So, in today's session, we are going to discuss about capital busting with the project, as well as the different techniques of capital busting, how it is helpful for the for taking decisions for future purpose. So I am sharing my slides. Is it visible?
Yes, sir, it is.
Okay, fine. So, this is the management development program day two on project or capitalist expenditure or budgeting decisions. So, before we are going to start the presentation, we need to know about the role and the definition of capital busting. So the role of the successful capital busting system is to do much more than to just make easy red light, green light decisions for individual projects. It has to take into account all the firm's long range planning processes and to figure out what line of business the firm has to concentrate on, and then set out plans for financing, production, marketing, research, and development, etc. So it must also tie into a procedure for measurement of performance. Otherwise, the firm has no way of knowing how its decision about capital expenditure finally turn out.
Dr. Vikas,
yes.
Sorry to interrupt. If you can little bit increase your voice, because we are receiving message that it is little low.
Just a minute. Is it okay now?
A little bit, sir. It is a little echoing. The voice is echoing.
No.
Yes, sir.
Is it okay now?
Yes, sir. If, a little bit of increase in volume maybe from your side.
Okay.
Thank you.
So I was discussing about the role. If I am audible now, so I am just repeating what I discussed earlier. So role of successful capital busting system, based upon different parameters, different processes, planning, and to figure out what line of business the firm has to concentrate on. So we are working on financing, then production, marketing, research and development. Okay, so we need to know, we need to go into a procedure for measurement of performance. Otherwise, whatever we are going to invest, we will not be in a position to say that we took a right decision for investment purpose. Because in case of capital expenditure, if we talk about project management, so heavy expenditure we are going to incur. So it is necessary to see the outcome, to see the future inflows for the business. All right. So here we can see about introduction. I hope I am audible. Investment decision of a firm, popularly known as the capital busting or capital expenditure decision, it may be defined as the firm's decision to invest its current funds most efficiently in long-term assets in anticipation of expected flow of benefits over a series of years. So whatever we are investing today, it will give benefit for more than a year, say 5 years, say 7 years, 10 years. So according to the project, we are going to see the inflow. So today we invest a heavy expenditure on the project, and our expectation, firm expectation, is to earn more and more return on that. It is a process of making investment decision in capital expenditure, defined as that expenditure which is incurred at one point of time, whereas the benefits of it are realized at different points of time in future. So as I said, today we are investing money, and what we are expecting, we are expecting benefits of it, which are going to realized at different points of time in future. So at the end of year one, year two, year three, and so on, up to the life of the project, we are expecting more and more profit on it after investing money. It involves sacrifice of a certain amount of present resources in exchange for a future return, and an arbitrage over time that involves risk. So we cannot predict about the future and what we are doing, because we are going to invest money and we are predicting about the future that in the year one we will earn so much profit, or in the year two profit is there like this. But we cannot predict. It means there is a risk involved. So based upon that, because we are sacrificing a heavy amount today for a future return, so we need to check how much risk is inherent. Project and capital expenditure. So capital expenditure have a major role to play in the economic development of a country. So whether we are investing money for a firm, but ultimately it is affecting on the economic development of a country. Capital expenditure are designed with the aim of efficient management, earning adequate return to provide for future development with their own resources. So in capital expenditure, it may take several forms, like cost of acquisition, addition, expansion, improvements in the fixed assets as land and building, plant and machinery, etc. Cost of replacement of permanent assets, we can see. Research and development expenditure, we are incurring. And diversification into new business areas. So as a business firm, we can see a new business. We can diversify. Okay. So the financial manager, before going in for any kind of investment, engages himself with rational matching of present value of benefits with present cost. So as to increase net present value of a project, which in turn will increase the market value of shares of a firm and ultimately maximizes shareholders' wealth. So it is the one of the financial management area where we need to see where everyone or every person of the organization or every investor are going to see how can we maximize the shareholders' wealth. A typical investment or capital busting involves certain sacrifices of resources now in exchange for an uncertain but hopefully large inflow of resources in the near or distant future. So we need to check. A capital expenditure has a set of objectives or a mission. Once the objectives are achieved, the project is treated as completed. Life cycle. A project has a life cycle. The life cycle consists of 5 stages. So as we know about the stages of life cycle, say starting from conception, then definition, then planning and organizing, implementation and commissioning stage. So these are the 5 stages where a project is based. If we talk about uniqueness, so every capital expenditure is unique and no 2 expenditures are similar. So setting up a cement plant and construction of a highway are 2 different projects having unique features. Okay. Now, teamwork. Capital expenditure is a teamwork and it normally consists of diverse areas. We can see because we are working in an organization, so everyone is contributing towards the growth of the organization. So there will be personnel specialized in their respective areas, and coordination among the diverse areas calls for teamwork. If we talk about complexity, a capital expenditure is a complex set of activities relating to diverse areas. And risk and uncertainty, as we have discussed about risk, because we cannot predict about the future, so risk and uncertainty go hand in hand with project. A risk-free, it only means that the element is not apparently visible on the surface and it will be hidden underneath. So while going into a project, we need to check risk and uncertainty for the project. Now, coming to the customer specific nature, a capital expenditure is always customer specific because it is the customer who decides upon the product to be produced or services to be offered. In present scenario, we can see what customer is demanding. Customer is in present situation, customer do not want to go to the market. So maximum in these days, customer is purchasing online. So now situation is changing. So it is the customer who decides product to be produced or services to be offered. And hence it is the responsibility of any organization to go for project services that are suited to customer needs. So as an organization, we need to see what customer is demanding. Accordingly, we have to incorporate some changes. Then about the change. So changes occur throughout the lifespan of a project as a natural outcome of many environmental factors. The changes may vary from minor changes, which may have very little impact on the project, to major changes, which may have a big impact or even may change the very nature of the project. So minor as well as major projects, major changes we are seeing and their impact on the project. Optimality. A capital expenditure is always aimed at optimum utilization of resources. So in the previous slide, we were talking about the maximization of shareholders' wealth. So here we can link this maximization with the optimum utilization of resources. So on the other way, it is going to reduce the cost. Okay, so optimum utilization of resources for the overall development of the economy, for the overall development of the organization. Now, unity in diversity. A capital expenditure is a complex set of thousands of varieties. The varieties are in terms of technology, equipment, material, machinery, and people, worker, culture, and others. Now coming to the project selection process. So these are the defined project selection process. Whenever we are going to see a project, or we want to start a new setup, or we want to diversify our business. Okay, so process is defined, well defined process of project selection, starting from idea generation. What is the idea behind? Before starting the project, then environmental appraisal, corporate appraisal, exploration for project ideas, preliminary screening about the project, then project rating index, sources of positive net present value. Here we are predicting about the future. Okay. And then entrepreneur qualities. Okay. So this is about your project selection process. Now, project ideas can be generated from various internal and external sources. What are those? We need to know about the market. We need to know about the products and services, what other competitors are providing. Knowledge of potential customer choices, as customer is demanding. Okay. So more choices means more expansion. Emerging trends and demand for particular product. So today, what customer is expecting, what is the demand, what is the demand of the market, and on the basis of that, we have to see for the future. Scope for producing substitute product, market survey and research, going through professional magazines, making visits to trade and exhibitions. So different sources we are generating informations or ideas from market, from customers, from you can say from substitute products, from surveys. We are doing surveys, we are going to professional magazines, we are participating in trade and exhibitions, we are seeing government guidelines and policies, ideas given by the experienced person, ideas by own experience. And last one is your SWOT analysis. We need to check according to our organization, okay, whatever we are going to implement or introducing. So we have to check SWOT analysis for that. Now, if we look about economic sector, we need to check state of the economy, the growth rate, overall growth rate, cyclical fluctuations, inflation rate, growth rate of primary, secondary and tertiary sector, growth rate of world economy, trade surplus and deficits, balance of payment. It is not necessary. All these points are applicable for all types of capital expenditures. Okay. If there is a small organization, or there is a large organization, or an organization who work on, say, overseas. So based upon that, based upon the situation, organizations are collecting informations. They are generating ideas. So one of the sector from where we are seeing the information about economy, economic sector. So what is the growth rate now? What is the inflation rate? What are the, you can say, growth rate of world economy? Then what about rate surpluses and benefits and all? We need to check for a large investment. Then about government sector, we need to check, we need to see industrial policies, government programs and projects, tax structure, exim policy, financing norms, subsidies, incentives and concessions, monetary policies. So time to time we have to see the policies which government announce. Okay, and on the basis of that, we incorporate changes for the project. Now, if we talk about technological sector, then emergence of new technologies, access to technical know-how, foreign as well as indigenous. Competition sector, number of firms in the industry and the market share of the top few. We have to see competition. Other competitors, degree of homogeneity and differentiation among the products, entry barrier, comparison with substitutes in terms of quality and prices, and marketing policies and practices. So in this sector, we are trying to get the information from our competitors, existing product as well as expected products. Then entry problems, entry barrier, comparisons. Then coming to the supplier sector. So in this situation, because we are investing money, so we need to check ki if raw material is available or not for that particular project and what is the cost. Again, availability we are checking for the energy and what is the cost. About capital structure, how much capital is required for that particular project, availability we are seeing, and what will be the cost of capital. Okay, so we need to check. Then about marketing and distribution. So this is about marketing, say market image, then product line, product mix, distribution channels, customer loyalty, marketing and distribution cost. So while going into investment in a project, so marketing is playing a role. Marketing is also playing a role. What is the product line? What is the market mix? Product mix. Then customer loyalty. Coming to the production and operations. If we see conditions and capacity of plant machinery, we need to see about the present status. Availability of raw material and power, degree of vertical integration, location advantage, cost structure. So here we are evaluating our production and operations, whether it is in favorable condition while implementing a new project or not. Then coming to the research and development. Research capabilities of the firm. So it is one of the important part. Research and development. Track record of new product developments. Laboratories and testing facilities. Coordination between research and operations. So this is the other area where we have to work. This is your research and development. We are checking, we are doing so many research activities for our product, okay, and we are implementing changes. But if customer is not satisfied, it means it is a failure. Now coming to the corporate resources and personnel. So corporate image, what is the corporate image of our organization? Then dynamism of top management. Relation with government and regulatory agencies, we need to check. We need to see the relationship with government and regulatory agencies and state of industry relations. Okay, so suppliers are ready to supply raw material or not? And others, fund providers, investors, they are ready to invest or not. Because if stakeholders are not showing their interests, so it will be very, problematic for an organization to expand their business activities. Finance and accounting. Financial leverage and borrowing capacity, cost of capital, tax structure, relation with shareholders and creditors, accounting and control system, cash flow and liquidity. So with these, we can check our finance and accounting. We can see how much capital is required and what will be the cost of capital. What is the cost of capital today and how much capital is required for expansion purpose and what will be the cost. Then about the tax structure, it is based on the government policies. If we want to expand or we want to going into a new business, if government is giving some taxation relief, so we need to check whether the area is available or not. So relationship we are checking with shareholders and creditors. This is about your finance and accounting part. Now project life cycle. So five stages you can say principal stages in the life of a project are identification, initial formulation, evaluation, final formulation, implementation and completion. Financial analysis. In order to adjust the financial viability of the project, the following aspects need to be carefully analyzed, like cost of capital, means of finance, estimates of sales and production, cost of production, working capital requirement and its financing, estimates of working results, break-even point, projected cash flow, projected balance sheet. So before investment, we need to work on these. We need to analyze carefully about cost of capital. If cost of capital is too high, so there is no need to go, because you are investing heavy expenditure. You are investing heavy money. And if your cost of capital is more than the return, then it is not a good condition for the organization. We need to see the break-even point. We need to check. We need to prepare projected cash flow, then projected balance sheet. So capital busting decisions may be defined as the firm's decisions to invest its current funds most efficiently in the long-term assets in anticipation of an expected flow of benefits over a series of years. So these are some discussion. In other words, capital busting is used to evaluate the expenditure decisions such as acquisition of fixed assets, changes in old assets and their replacement. Activities such as changes in the method of sales distribution or undertaking an advertisement campaign or a research and development program have long-term implications. So whatever we are investing, it is for long-term. Therefore, they may also be evaluated as investment decisions. Features of capital busting. Investment of fund is made in long-term assets. It is for long-term. The exchange of current funds for future benefits. Future profits accrue to the firm over several years. And these decisions are more risky. Because we are, today we are investing for future. And future is uncertain. We cannot predict 100%. We are not very much sure ki whatever we are calculating today, 100% we will achieve. No, we cannot. Okay. So every time we see, these decisions are more risky. Now coming to the importance, growth, the effect of investment decisions extend into the future and have to endure for a longer period than the consequences of the current operating expenditure. This is about the growth. Then risk. A long-term commitment of funds may also change the risk complexity of the firm. If the adoption of an investment increases average gain but causes frequent fluctuations in its earnings, the firm will become very risky. Then funding. Investment decisions generally involve large amount of funds. So funds are a scarce resource in our country. Hence the capital busting decision is very important. So importance of capital expenditure decisions, we are studying into five ways. So first one is your growth, then risk, then funding. And fourth one is your irreversibility. So most investment decisions are irreversible. If we invest it, so it is not possible to reverse
the decision. Okay, otherwise organization will face lot of losses. Will have to bear. Then complexity. Investment decisions are among the firm's most difficult decisions. They are concerned with assessment of future events, which are difficult to predict. It is really a complex problem to correctly estimate the future cash flow of investment. So today we are expecting in the next year, 10% return will be available. In the second year, 15% return will be available. But we are not sure. Okay. Objectives of capital bursting decisions. So capital bursting helps in selection of profitable projects. A company should have a system for estimating cash flow of projects. A multidisciplinary team of managers should be assigned the task of developing cash flow estimates. Once cash flow have been estimated, projects should be evaluated to determine their profitability. So today we are estimating cash flow for future years according to the life of the project. So what we are going to expect in the year 1, year 2, year 3 and so on up to the end of the project. So a team of managers should be assigned the task of developing cash flow estimates. In between, in the life of the project, somewhere we have to spend some money. So that we have to check. Today we are investing money, and after so many years, say 2 years or 3 years, we will have to invest some more money. So we need to check how much amount that time will be required. Then evaluations criteria chosen should correctly rank the projects. Once the projects have been selected, they should be monitored and controlled. Proper authority should exist for capital spending. Critical projects involving large sum of money may be supervised by the top management. The company should have a sound capital budgeting and reporting system for this purpose. So based on the comparison of actual and expected performance, projects should be reappraised and remedial action should be taken. Okay, so based on the comparison, what is the actual value and what is the expected performance? Now after that, we can reappraise it. If it is not giving in the right direction, so organization should be reappraised. Now coming to the kinds of capital expenditure decision, one is expansion and diversification. A company may add capacity to its existing product lines to expand existing operations. For example, a fertilizer company may increase its plant capacity to manufacture in more areas. Diversification of existing business require investment in new product and a new kind of production activity within the firm. So investment in existing or new products may also be called as revenue expansion investment. So this is one of the kind of capital expenditure called expansion and diversification, where we are going into a new business, new product, new kind of production activity within the firm. Okay, so investment in existing or new products. This is about your expansion and diversification. Now, coming to the replacement and modernization. The main objective of modernization and replacement is to improve operating efficiency and reduce cost. asset become outdated and obsolete as a result of technological changes. So this technique helps, this kind of capital expenditure helps to the organization replacement and modernization. So if asset become outdated and there is no use now, so now firm must decide to replace those assets or a part of the asset with new that operate more economically. If a cement company change, for an example, if a cement company change from semi-automatic drying equipment to fully automatic drying equipment, it is an example of modernization and replacement. Okay, so this is about the replacement and modernization, where we are changing the existing asset with new one. We are replacing one of the part. We are replacing one of the part of the asset. And so on. Next one is your mutually exclusive investment. Mutually exclusive investments serve the same purpose and compete with each other. If one investment is selected, other will have to be rejected. A company may, for example, either use more labor intensive semi-automatic machine or employ a more capital intensive highly machine for production. Now coming to the next kind, this is about independent investment. So in case of independent investment, it serves different purposes and do not compete with each other. For example, a heavy engineering company may be considering expansion of its plant capacity to manufacture additional excavators and adding new production facilities to manufacture a new product, say light commercial vehicles. So depending on their profitability and availability of funds, the company can undertake both investment. So independent investment we are talking about. Now coming to the next one, which is contingent investment. So contingent investment are dependent projects. The choice of one investment necessitates undertaking one or more other investments. You can see an example. If a company decided to build a factory in a remote backward area, it may have to invest in houses, roads, hospitals, schools, etc. The total expenditure will be treated as one single investment. So the choice of one investment necessitates undertaking one or more other investments. So this is about your contingent investment. Now coming to the capital budgeting process. So here we are seeing planning, analysis, selection, implementation, review. So in project, in life cycle, we saw these points, say about planning, analysis, then selection, implementation and review. So it is very important to select the best investment proposal. It is necessary to analyze various proposals in the light of the corporate strategies and submits the suitable proposals to the capital expenditure planning committee or any name. Within the organization, we see the committees formed for investing purpose. So planning committee of the business enterprise committee views and checks these proposals and compares it with the company strategies. It is important to fix the priorities, because on the basis of priorities, decisions are taken and proposals are selected. Then what we see, when the project is implemented, it is very essential to assign responsibilities for completing the project, so as to avoid unnecessary delays and cost overruns. The evaluation is made through the comparison of actual expenditure, which is the with the budgeted one. If any variation exists, then steps may be taken to remove these in future. So within these five phases, we are going to invest. So planning, analysis, selection, implementation, and review. Now, criteria of capital busting. One of the criteria is non-discounting. The method of capital busting are the techniques which are used to make comparative evaluation of profitability of investment. The non-discounting methods of capital are as follows. Say payback period method is one of the non-discounting criteria, and second one is accounting rate of return method. So we calculate, we see, we predict on the basis of criteria whether the project is right or not, or giving a good return in the future or not. So this is about discounting criteria called net present value method, internal rate of return method, profitability index method. So in the next session, we are going to discuss about these non-discounting and discounting criteria. So finally, capital is a limited resource, whether it is in the form of debt or equity, either short term or long term, or retained earnings. The scarcity of capital or resources coupled with the importance of the investment decision in maximizing the long term value of the firm requires focus on sound investment appraisal. This forms the basis of emergence of techniques of capital busting. So this is from my side. If there is any question, then you can ask.
Participants are requested to put up their questions in the chat box, or they can also raise their hand so that they can directly interact with the resource person. I don't see any questions so far.
I think it is clear to all.
Yes, sir. We can take this as assumption. Okay. Thank you so much, sir, for enlightening us on the capital budgeting process and how important investment decisions can be taken efficiently within the organization. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Now, it is time to invite our second resource person for the day, Dr. Pooja Chaturvedi Sharma. She is an assistant professor at Geetharatan International Business School. Ma'am did her graduation from Delhi University and completed her master's degree in business administration from Bharti Vidyapeeth Deemed University, New Delhi. She is also UGC NET JRF qualified and has completed her PhD in finance from Bharti Vidyapeeth Deemed University, New Delhi. She is a lifetime member of All India Commerce Association and is also an active reviewer in UGC Approved and Scopus Index Generals. She has been awarded Young Research Scholar Award under Saimuddin Memorial ICA Research Scholar Award at All India Commerce Association Conference. Dr. Sharma's research interests are focused on sustainable finance, behavioral finance, mutual funds, and stock investing. We welcome you, ma'am. Ma'am, you're requested to please begin with the session.
Thank you, ma'am.
Just a moment, ma'am. We have a question here for Dr. Vikas. Sir, if we can take up this question.
Yes, ma'am.
Krutika is asking, for a startup, what do we keep in mind on the financial part? So how do we take the financial decisions?
In financial, as I already discussed, we need to know, we need to check about the fund, how much fund is required, then what is the cost of capital for this part, cost of capital, then the sources of financing, cost of production, estimates of sales and production, then estimates of working capital, break-even point, projected cash flows. So we have to see all these while starting a new product or we want to start a new unit. All right.
I hope, Kritika, that sir has answered to your question. Okay, yes. Thank you, Kritika. Thank you so much. Okay. Thank you, Vikas sir. So over to you, Pooja ma'am. You can continue with the session.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. I just need to know, Neha ma'am, is the PPT visible? Neha ma'am, is the PPT visible?
It is visible.
Okay. Okay. So, good evening, everyone. And congratulations, Vikas sir, for delivering such a wonderful session. It was really very informative. And now I would take you to a further process from where Sir left. Sir has briefed us about the concept, the criteria related to capital budgeting. Now we will talk about the discounting cash flow techniques. We will talk about majorly the techniques which are practically used in organizations. But when before we actually get onto the numericals and the spreadsheets, there is a background which I want to create. You know, there are some questions which you need to ask to yourself before deciding upon which criteria you need to pick up, right? So we need to ask ourselves the following questions when evaluating decision criteria. Does the decision rule adjust for the time value of money? We are going to talk about the relevance and importance of time value of money from the perspective of financial decision making in forthcoming slides. Does the decision rule adjust for risk? Definitely. Every project, every decision involves various kinds of risk. The levels of risk can be different. But yes, definitely there would be some risk, and we always want to minimize the risk. As we know, risk cannot be completely eliminated, but yes, we always work on minimizing the associated risk. Does the decision rule provide information on whether we are creating value for the firm? So yes, something at onset which we really look for is the wealth creation. Are we actually creating wealth? Are we actually maximizing wealth for our stakeholders, which is the fundamental norm, which is the fundamental motive for any business to continue? If a business is not able to maximize the wealth of its stakeholders, then it is not going to stay in the long run. So we need to look at these questions before deciding about any of the criteria. We know that yes, sir has just told us that capital budgeting is the process of determining the viability to long-term investments on purchase or replacement of property, plant and equipment, new product line or any other projects. Some related concepts of capital budgeting are, one of them is the time preference for money, as we just talked about time value of money. We all know that yes, definitely time is money these days. Why? due to risk, due to preference for consumption, and due to available investment opportunities. Risk means the longer the time period of an investment or a project, the higher the risk you have. You know, if a project has risk has a duration of say 3 years or 5 years or 10 years, then you are bound with the project for coming 10 years. And you have exposed yourself to all the uncertainties which are going to come up in the coming 10 years, right? Whereas if a project has a duration of only 3 months, then definitely you are exposed to only 3 months for various kinds of risk to which that industry belongs to. So definitely shorter the time period, lesser is the risk, and vice versa. Preference for consumption. Preference for consumption basically comes like the availability. If you have funds available with you, then you can definitely do it, use it for consumption purpose. Investment opportunities, yes, definitely. You can have better investment opportunities. If you are just tied up in a project or you've just invested in some short-term investment avenue for a period of say 4 months or 5 months or 91 days. So you can still look up for something better which is available in the market, and as that tenure completes, you can switch on to a better return giving investment avenue. So definitely these are the three reasons due to which we always say that time is money these days. Something very important before coming to numericals of capital budgeting, required rate of return, which is majorly known as R, is something which everybody needs to understand. Why this rate of return is required? Why this rate of return is estimated? Why it is basically required by the investors? Time preference for money is generally expressed by an interest rate. This rate will be positive even in the absence of any risk. Therefore, it may be called risk-free rate of return. Risk-free rate of return means as there is no risk at all. But in reality, this is not the case, because when we see the reality, it is actually not the case. Everybody, every project, every investment is exposed to some or the other kind of risk. Therefore, investors need something to compensate them. Right? See, there are two things. If you're investing your funds in some project, or if you're investing your funds in some investment avenue, you are at, you know, you have two aspects to this. One is that you are giving your time, you are sticking with that project, with that investment avenue for that particular tenure. And second is that you are exposing yourself with the associated risk. So you need to get two things. You need to get compensations for these two factors. One is time, and the other one is for bearing risk. This risk-free rate of return compensates you for the time which you give to that particular investment avenue. Risk-free rate is simply the compensation for being in the investment, being in the project. And risk premium is something which you receive for bearing that particular risk. Higher the risk, higher would be the risk premium. Higher the duration of that particular project or investment avenue, higher would be your risk-free rate of return. Fine. So two things we have talked about. Our required rate of return basically includes risk-free rate and risk premium. And why this is required by people or by investors? Because they are investing two things. They are investing their time and they are exposing themselves to risk. So definitely they want to be compensated for this. So required rate of return is risk-free rate plus risk premium. Next is time, role of time value tables. When we talk about time value techniques, there are majorly two techniques which are followed: compounding and discounting. Compounding is the technique which gives us future value for present payments or present receivables. If we receive 100 rupees today, what will be its value 5 years down the line? Compounding is what will be the value of present or current payments or receivables 5 years down the line. Whereas discounting talks about some money which we are going to receive after 5 years, what will be its present value, right? In calculating these things, time value tables play a very important role. These tables present discount rates that are used for various combinations of interest rates and time periods. See, if we are focusing on compounding technique, then the tables related are CVF table and CVAF table. CVF table is basically compounding value factor, and CVAF is compounding value factor for annuity. Whereas if we are following discounting technique, then we have PVF table and PVAF table. It is present value interest factor table, and PVAF is present value interest factor table for annuity. Now, what is the difference? CVF and PVF tables are used when we have payments or incomes only once. If there is only one payment, then also we can use CVF or PVF. Or if we have multiple payments, multiple incomes, but with uneven cash flows, when the amount is not same every time. Every time you're receiving or you're paying a different amount, that calls for CVF or PVF table. Whereas CVAF or PVAF calls for annuity, means when you're paying same amount annually. Every year when you're paying same amount installments, that calls for annuity. So CVAF or PVAF will be used when we are using annuity, something regularly, same amount we are paying every year. So the bottom line of all this framework is that these calculations, the time value related calculations, demonstrate that time literally is money. The value of the money you have now is not the same as it will be in the future, and vice versa. So it is important to know how to calculate the time value of money so that you can distinguish between the worth of investments that offer you returns at different times. Now we will move ahead towards our first technique for the day, which is net present value method, and we call it NPV as well. NPV is basically the difference between the market value of a project and its cost. And this technique helps us to understand how much value is created from undertaking a particular investment or a particular project. Money in the present is worth more than the same amount in future. We just had a discussion about it. Due to inflation and to earnings from alternative investments that could be made during the intervening period. The discount rate elements of the NPV formula is a way to account for this. For example, assume that an investor could choose a 10,000 rupees payment today or in a year. Either he has two options, either he can receive 10,000 rupees today or he can receive it after 1 year. A rational investor would not be willing to postpone the payment. We just had three reasons: risk, preference for consumption, and investment opportunities. Considering all those three options and reasons, no rational investor would like to postpone the payment. However, what if an investor could choose to receive 10,000 today or 11,000 in a year? See, there is a difference of 1,000 rupees if he is receiving the amount after 1 year. If the payer was reliable, that extra 10% may be worth the wait. But only if there wasn't anything else the investor could do with the 10,000 that would earn more than 10%. Whatever you're receiving today or whatever you're going to receive after 1 year, you know, this is the best amount, or this is the best percentage, or this is the best return which I'm gaining, then this is the best decision for you. But if you know that you can get something better, then definitely you should not go for this 10%. An investor might be willing to wait a year to earn an extra 10%, but that may not be acceptable for all investors. In this case, the 10% is the discount rate, or it is the required rate of return, the R, which we just discussed, which will vary depending on the investor. If an investor knew they could earn 12% from a relatively safe investment over the next year, they would not be willing to postpone payment for 10%. In this case, the investor's discount rate is 12%, because this is something, what do you expect? This is something, what is your required rate of return? Because you know that in market, same return is available. So why to go for 10% when market is offering you 12%, right? So merits of NPV method are definitely, it considers time value of money, the amounts of cash flows. It measures the true profitability of the project. It shows you how much we are going to add on to the value of the company, how much you are going to add on to the shareholders' value if you opt for this project. So NPV should be found by subtracting present value of cash outflows from present values of cash inflows. What is the acceptance rule? Decision rule would be to accept the project when NPV is positive. NPV is positive means when it is more than zero. What does it mean? Considering the previous slide, when your inflows are more than your outflows, then definitely your NPVs are going to be positive. And a project which gives you more inflows than outflows, definitely that is a better option to opt for. Whereas reject the project when NPV is negative. When NPV is going to be negative, NPV is going to be negative when your outflows are more than your inflows. But what if your NPV is equal to zero? Means your present value of your cash inflows and present value of your cash outflows both are equal. What will you do in that case? In that case, company may opt, a firm may accept the project, because there might be various other reasons. There might be, say, you need some brand association. You know, you need to be associated with a particular brand. So considering all those reasons, you might accept a project with NPV equal to zero. A positive NPV means that the project is expected to add value to the firm and will therefore increase the wealth of the owners. Since our goal is to increase owners' wealth, NPV is a direct measure of how well this project will meet our goal. So we have just discussed that there are some uneven cash flows, there are some even cash flows. So if you have some even cash flows, like you're paying same amount every year, then the formula would be C multiplied by PVFA minus I, where C stands for the cash inflows expected to be received each period. PVFA is the present value factor for annuity when you receive or you pay same amount every year. And I is the initial investment. Just have a look at a example. Calculate the net present value of a project which requires an initial investment of ₹2,43,000, and it is expected to generate a cash inflow of ₹50,000 each month for 12 months. Assume that the salvage value of the project is zero. Salvage value is the amount which company expects to receive even when the project is complete or even when an asset is of no use to the company. The target rate of return is 12% per annum. This target rate is the R which we were discussing, right? So what is given to us? Initial investment, 2,43,000. Cash inflow per period, ₹50,000. Number of periods, 12. Discount rate given is for the entire 12 periods. What is the discount rate per period? That is 1%. Because 12 periods are there, 12% discount rate is there. So for 1% for one period. I think till here it is clear to everyone. Any doubt? Any doubt, or we can move ahead? Okay. So how we will calculate? We will simply see the table. First of all, first step is to see the table. What you will do with the table, PFA table, you can check it at 1% and 12 period. We had a discussion. I just told you that these time value tables presents different combinations of interest rates and time periods, and they give discounted factor values. So when we see the table, PVFA table at 1% for 12 periods, the value which we receive, the discounting factor which we receive is 11.255. This is the value of PVFA. Now simply we will put the formula, the values in the formula. C is the 50,000. This is the amount which we have received every year, every period, 50,000 regularly, multiplied by 11.255, which is the value of PVFA minus the initial investment. Initial investment was 2,43,000. So on deducting, we received 3,19,750. If you are going to accept this project, you are going to add value of 3,19,750 to the company. Then definitely this is a good project. Company can go for it because it has a positive NPV, and which is a good number. So definitely company can go for it, right? Now, we will calculate some more examples of NPV through spreadsheet. See, this is a case. What we are seeing is that this is a 4 years project with an initial investment. The numbers in the parentheses, which is $350, shows the initial investment. Zero is the year. Zero is the year of initial investment when you start the project. 350 is the initial investment, followed by inflows. And once you're paying it only, and then you have regular incomes. We have, I hope some of you must have some investment policies in which there is only one-time payment, and then we keep on receiving the inflows, right? So in year one, we are going to receive $100. In year two, we are going to receive $200. In year three, we are going to receive $150. And in the final year, $75. Interest rate, R is the 5%. R is 5%. So now what we will do? We need to calculate the present value of all these cash flows first, right? See, we are going to calculate NPV from two different methods. This is the first method, and then I will take you to different method, right? So first we need to calculate the present value. How we will calculate it? First, we need to see the amount of initial investment, which is the column cell B3, which is $350. Divided by 1 plus F1. F1 is the 5% interest rate. It is the cell where 5 is written. 5%, I think all of you can see. 5% is the F1 cell divided, raised to the power A3. A3 is the cell of years. 0, 1, 2, 3. A3 is for 0. A4 is for year 1. A5 is for year 2. I hope everyone is with me. So what we are doing is we picked up cash flow divided by 1 plus R raised to the power N. N is the number of years, right? So because this is the year zero, we are just investing. So it is simply zero. And when we will scroll it down, we will drag it. We are going to receive it as 1, 2, 3, and 4. Now, what next? Next is that when we are using here F1, F1 is the 5% interest rate, and we want to freeze this interest rate. We don't want to change it. So what we will do, we need to freeze it. What we will do, how can we do this? We just need to put the cursor between F and 1 and simply press F4. I'm repeating. If you want to freeze the value of a cell in a formula, you can just put the cursor between the digit of the value of that cell. Here it is F1. You need to put your cursor between F and 1 and simply press F4, the shortcut key, and press enter. Once you press enter and then drag all the values, see, you can drag the values from this right hand corner where there is a dot, right? You can press it where there is a dot and simply drag it, which will give us all these values. So these all values are the present values of all the cash flows. You know, what does it indicate? It indicates that 100 rupees, which you are going to receive after 1 year, is going to have purchase value or is going to have value equal to 95.24 rupees. 200 rupees, which you are going to receive after 2 years, is going to have a value or a purchase value or market value equal to 181 rupees, 181.41 rupees. Right? Now, we have cash flows, we have calculated present values. What we need to do is we will just add it all. We will simply just add it all by the formula equal to sum and then select all the cells. Starting from C3. C3 is the cell where $350 is written, and then we will take it up to last, year 4. We will take all the cells, C3 to C7, and then enter. So this is simply the total present value of the entire project. Now we need to calculate the net present value. How we will calculate? We will calculate it with the formula. Here, we need to add on the is equal to sign, and then we will add on this 350 cell. 350, which is the initial investment. You need to take initial investment plus type the formula NPV. And the formula of NPV requires what? It requires R, which is 5% in the columns F1, in the cell C1, F1, sorry. And then followed by all your inflows. Not your outflows, only your inflows, which are in the column B and which is from cell B4 to B7. I hope everyone is able to find what we're talking about. C3 is your initial investment plus NPV in parentheses, because NPV's formula asks you about your required rate of return, which is 5%, and you need to tell the formula also about, or you need to tell the software about the inflows which you are going to receive. So you have selected all these things and simply press enter. So what you saw? You saw that this is the same value which you just received from by calculating the present value. See, yes, we started with a long procedure. If you want to calculate NPV directly from spreadsheet, you can simply do the last formula, this C3 NPV F1 B4 B7, simply directly. But I started with the background. I gave you the presentation in case if you don't know how to calculate the present value. So you can simply calculate the present values, and their entire total will also give you the amount equal to NPV, or else if you want to go through spreadsheet formula, this is the formula you need to follow, where you need to add on the initial investment plus NPV with the formula R and your all cash inflows. I hope it's clear to everyone. Now, what will happen? This is the NPV at the rate of 5%. If our required rate is 5%, then NPV is 117.92. What will happen if I change the interest rate? See, if I make it 7 from 5, see the cell F1 where interest rate is written. If it is 5, and what will happen if I change it to 7? Now see, C9 cell, it is going to be 97.81. Yes, it is going to be 97.81. See, NPV has reduced. What if I change it from 7 to 10%? What will happen? It has further reduced. See, the more we want, the lesser we will get. The higher would be the standard. If we want 5%, when we want 7%, when we want 10%, as we are increasing our required rate of return, our final input is reducing. Why? Because this is the final thing, because this is the final net thing what you are going to add on to your company. This is the final amount which is going to be added to your kitty. So as you increase the R, your NPV is going to decrease. This is the kind of association we can observe, right? Okay, this is another example. Here we will take some other features. We will use some other parameters. This is a project for 5 years, which has multiple inflows and outflows. Throughout all the 5 years, there are inflows as well as there are outflows. So, and the discount rate is 5%. how we will calculate? First, we need to calculate the net cash flows. Net cash flows basically means actually what you have received after deducting your outflows from your inflows. So in the first column, as there is nothing in inflows, only outflows are there. So B2 minus C2, it is definitely going to be a negative figure, 50,000. In the next year, you received 20,000, whereas you paid 5,000. So what is going to be a net cash flow? 15,000 rupees. And so on. In the second year, 14,000 minus 2,000, 12,000 minus 2,000. So this is going to be your net cash flows. I think this is clear to everyone, because we need to calculate on single figure. We cannot juggle up again and again between cash inflows and outflows. So we need to come up to a net value. Now, what is this? After net cash flows, we have simply put a formula of NPV, which is a little different formula which we just used in the last question. This is equal to NPV. In the parenthesis, what is required? Your rate, your R, which is 5%. And we are taking all the inflows. Here we have not considered by any means the initial investment amount. In the previous formula, we have used the initial investment amount, but here in this formula, we have not used the initial investment amount. We have simply used our R and the amount of our cash inflows, right? So this 53,004 is the present value of all future cash flows. From this, we will deduct our initial investment now. Here we will deduct the initial investment, which will give us an NPV, which is 3004. 3004 is a positive value. So yes, this particular project is going to add on an amount equal to 3004. So definitely company can go for this project as well, right? When we're talking about NPV and R, these are two different parameters. Rate of return and NPV are two different parameters. There is a regular confusion. There is a regular dilemma among financial managers, which method to opt for. It is very simple. If you're following NPV rule, invest in any project that has a positive NPV when cash flows are discounted at the opportunity cost of capital. Opportunity cost of capital, expected rate of return, required rate of return, these are all the synonyms for R, which we have discussed in the initial slides. Rate of return, R is simply invest in any project offering a rate of return that is higher than the opportunity cost of capital. If you are going to invest those funds somewhere else, what is the return you are expecting? If the R is for this particular project is higher than the opportunity cost, then definitely you can go for this particular project. But yes, there are some drawbacks of this particular technique as well, which says that gauging on an investment's profitability with NPV relies heavily on assumptions and estimates. So there can be substantial room for error. Estimated factors include investment cost, discount rate, and projected returns. A project may often require unforeseen expenditures to get off the ground or may require additional expenditures at the project's end. So, financial managers need to be cautious while using this particular technique. So, the bottom line for the concept of NPV is that the calculation used to find today's value of a future stream of payments, it accounts for the time value of money and can be used to compare investment alternatives that are similar. The NPV relies on a discount rate of return that may be derived from the cost of capital required to make the investment, and any project or investment with a negative NPV should be avoided. An important drawback of using an NPV analysis is that it makes assumptions about future events that may not be reliable. Something very important which we always need to keep in our mind, that we are assuming, we are predicting about future events, and we all know that future is uncertain. So definitely we all need to keep these things in mind while using this particular technique. Next technique which we will take today is IRR, which is also called internal rate of return. This is the most important alternative to NPV. companies which are little reluctant in using NPV go for IRR. It is often used in practice and is intuitively appealing. It is based entirely on the estimated cash flows and is independent of interest rates found elsewhere. The internal rate of return is the true economic return earned by the asset over its life. This method takes into account the magnitude and timings of cash. Magnitude means what is the amount of cash, you know, what is the amount of cash flows. Definitely comparing a project with an inflow of 50,000 and another project with an inflow of 5,000. Definitely there is a difference. The magnitude of the project with 50,000 inflow is higher, right? So it considers the magnitude and timings of cash flows. In this method, rate of return depends on the project's cash flow rather than any outside factor. That's why it is called internal rate of return, you know, because it is entirely related to the project. The internal rate of return is computed by finding the discount rate that will cause the NPV of a project to be zero. IRR is the return that makes the NPV equal to zero. Now, in this context, what is the decision rule? Accept the project if the IRR is greater than the required return. If IRR percentage is higher than your R, which your required rate of return, then definitely you can go for that particular project. What are the advantages of using IRR? It helps in knowing a return which is intuitively appealing. It is a simple way to communicate the value of a project to someone who doesn't know all the estimation details. If the IRR is high enough, you may not need to estimate a required return, which is often a difficult task. So we will be calculating some IRR examples with spreadsheet. Okay, so here we will talk about the same example which we have just done during NPV. The first example which we have taken, where there was a 4 years long project with $350 initial investment, followed by regular cash inflows of $100, $200, $150 and $75. See, look at the row number 10, where it is in last, where it is return internal rate of return. Simply, we are putting the formula, which is IRR, and what it expects you to input in the parenthesis. We will be taking all the inflows, including the cash inflows and the outflows. So we will be taking it from B3 to B7, which is $350, which is a negative figure, your initial investment, followed by all the four cash inflows, right? And then 6%. From where does this 6% came? This is a reasonable percentage which you expect that, you know, your R is say 10. So you have come up with something 8. Your R in the question, the R was 5. When we initially started, the R was 5. So we have taken it as 6. So you can basically take a reasonable number. It is a trial method. So you can take something which is closer to the R, what you expect. So because in the question, we have taken 5% as the R. So we have taken here 6 as the new percentage. Now, the IRR is 19%. By using this formula, which we get as IRR is the 19%. Now what I will do, I will just increase some decimal places to get you to the exact percentage which has come, which is 19.25614. This project says that this particular project is going to give you a return of 19.25614. And your expected return was 5%. So definitely this sounds really good. You're expecting 5%, whereas you're getting 19%. So you can go for it. But how we will cross-check it, that yes, this is the right IRR. Another way, the reverse approach could be to check that if this is the right IRR, then this percentage should make my NPV equal to zero. We have been talking about this. If this IRR makes my NPV zero, then definitely this is the right IRR. How we will calculate that? What we can do is in F1, where it is written as 10, I can replace this 10 by this IRR percentage, by 19.25614. F1 is there in the formula when we have calculated NPV. See the column, see the cell F1. We have replaced the previous 10% with the same percentage of IRR? And now we need to see, is the NPV coming out to be zero? If yes, then it is the right IRR. If no, then there is some discrepancy. Yes. See, NPV is coming out to be zero. All the values have changed. I'll just take you back. You can see the present value when we were taking R as 5%, the present value of 100 rupees after year one was 90.91. Whereas when I took 19.25 as R, value got reduced to 83.85. Definitely everything has changed, which has actually made our NPV equal to zero. So yes, this is the right percentage of IRR and we are happy to accept this project. But yes, what? But if we increase, if I increase this particular IR or if I increase this R from 19.25614, if I make it 20%, then what? Then NPV is going negative. At 20%, we have better opportunities in market to go. Don't go for this particular project. But if it is 19.25, then yes, you are happy. You can still accept this project. Fine. I hope I'm making myself clear to everyone. If you have any questions, you can write in the chat. We will follow up in between as well. No issues. Okay. So I think this is clear to everyone that at 20%, NPV is becoming negative. So we are not going with the project anymore. But yes, if IRR we are taking at 19.25614, then definitely we can go with it. Okay. Now there have been various clashes between NPV and IRR. NPV and IRR will generally give us the same decision. But yes, there are some exceptions also, like when the projects are mutually exclusive, when there are initial investments are substantially different. Definitely a project which has a huge gap in the initial investment, then definitely results are going to be different. And timings of cash flows is substantially different. A project which has regular cash inflows and outflows, another project which has just one time come and go. So that is the case which is definitely going to be an exceptional in this case. I will just take you through the case of mutually exclusive projects. In case of mutually exclusive projects, you can select only one. You can select either A project or B project. You can't choose both. For example, like you can choose to attend graduate school at either Harvard or Stanford, but not both. Or there can be reasons of, mutually opting for only one. There can be some financial exclusiveness. There can be some capital rationing, means limitation of funding. So due to which company is in a position to accept only one project, either of them, but not both. Now, what can be done? If you have to select only one project, what you need to do or what you can do is if you follow NPV project, NPV method, then you can go with the project giving you higher NPV. Or if you go with the IRR, then you can go with the project giving you higher IRR. In either case, you need to see the higher value. A project which gives you higher value of the statistical technique which you have taken, financial technique which you have taken, you can go only with that particular project. Okay. The next technique for the day is discounted payback. This is the revised version. This is the more usable version of the traditional payback method, which was initially in the usage. This project basically tells us about how long does it take to get the initial cost back in a nominal sense. What will be the duration when we are going to get our initial investment back? What is the decision rule here? Accept if the payback period is less than some preset limit. If you expect to receive or if you have if you know about the market, if you know about the industry, if you have the experience, so you know that I have invested say 5 lakh rupees in a particular project and I expect to receive it back within 5 years. If this particular project is going to pay you back in a period less than 5 years, then definitely you can go for this. If it is taking longer than that, then definitely there is no point, right? The shorter the payback period, lesser the risk and better the situation it is, right? I'm repeating. Shorter the payback period, lesser the risk, and better is the position of the company. Because, you know, your initial investment is all back, and now whatever you're earning, it is over and above your initial investment. So what are the advantages and disadvantages? It includes time value of money. It is easy to understand. It does not accept negative estimated NPV investments when all future cash flows are positive. What are the disadvantages? It may reject positive NPV investments. It requires an arbitrary cutoff point, like the for the time duration in years and in months. It ignores cash flows beyond the cutoff point, and it is biased against long-term projects such as R&D and new products. So what is going to be the decision criteria test that whether we should go for discounted payback or not? You need to see and check, does the payback rule account for the time value of money? Yes. Does the payback rule account for the risk of the cash flows? You know, because there can be projects where in a project, okay, I'll give an example. In project A, you see that the amount of cash flows is little less, but it is consistent. You know, for it is a 10 years project, and every year that particular project is giving you 50,000 rupees. Fine. Whereas the project B is giving you irregular returns. Sometime in a duration, although both the projects are giving you same inflows, both the projects are going to give you say 5 lakh rupees. But project B, in year one, it is going to give you 70,000 rupees. In year two, it is going to give you 35,000 rupees. In year three, it is going to give you again 40,000 rupees. In year four, it is going to give you 50,000 rupees. And in year five, it comes back to 20,000 rupees again. So this is the kind of risk associated. This, the project B is more riskier as compared to project A, right? So payback period considers all that. Does the payback rule provide an indication about the increase in value? Or should we consider the payback rule for our primary decision criteria? You need to see what is your priority basically. Are you only concerned about the time duration? Or there are some other criteria as well. Do you want to add on to shareholders' wealth? Do you want to add on to company value? Do you want to add on to your goodwill? Do you want to, do you want to have better liquidity? So what are your criteria? What are your priorities? According to that, you can decide whether you would like to go for discounted payback period as your main decision criteria or not. So we will be taking it through spreadsheet again. This is a case. It's an 8 years project with an initial investment of 3 lakh rupees. And 80,000 rupees would be received regularly for initial 3 years. And in rest of the years, we will be receiving 50,000 rupees regularly. First, what we will do, we need to calculate the discount factor. R given here is 9%. Formula, you can write down, formula for discount factor here would be 1 upon 1 plus R raised to the power N. 1 divided by 1 plus R raised to the power N. R is basically the required rate of return, which is written here as in decimal. And N is the number of years. You know, if you do it individually, as we will be doing in spreadsheet, when you're doing it for in the first year, your N would be 0. When you're doing it for fourth year, your N would be 4. When you're doing it for seventh year, your N will be 7, right? So discount formula for discount factor is 1 upon 1 plus R raised to the power N. So this is what they have taken, 1 divided by 1.09. 1.09 is 9 is the rate of return, 0.09. plus 1. So 1 plus 0.09 gives you 1.09 raised to the power E59. E59 is your this zero column, which is 0 year, right? This is the 0 year. So what we did, we just dragged it all and we got all the discounting factors for all the years. Now, what we need to calculate? Next, we need to calculate discounted cash flows. DCF stands for discounted cash flows. What is the formula? It is as simple as that. Simply, you are multiplying discount factor with the cash flows. So, discounted cash flows. When discount factor is multiplied to cash flows, right? So, this gives us 1 multiplied by negative 3 lakh. In the next cell, we will write 0.91743119 multiplied by $80,000, right? So this is how we will get, see, 0.91743119 multiplied by $80,000. So this is how we got all the discounted cash flows. We had the normal cash flows, we calculated the discounting factors, and accordingly we also calculated the discounted cash flows, because payback period, discounted payback period works on the discounted cash flows only, definitely, because it's a method, it's a process based on discounting technique. So we need to work on the cash flows which are discounted back, right? Now we will calculate the payback period. How we will do it? We need to see 3 lakh is your initial investment, and discounted cash flow column shows you the amount which you have received. This is the inflow. So what we need to do is, 3 lakh is a negative value. In a negative value, if I add something, this will give me the balance, 3 lakh plus this 73,000 something. This will give me the balance which is remaining to be received now. Out of 3 lakh, how much is remaining? See, all these figures in red shows you the negative figures. In the parenthesis shows you the negative figure. When we received out of 3 lakh 73,394.50 in year 1, the balance was 2,26,605.50. On receiving regular payments, finally in 5th year, the balance is 29,578.60. Whereas in 6th year, the payment which we are going to receive is 29,813.37, which is more than this. So this shows we are due with 29,578 and we are going to receive 29,813. So we can estimate that we are going to receive our initial investment completely back within 5th and 6th year. I hope I'm making myself clear to everyone. Okay. So this is the difference, and we expect to receive our initial investment completely between 5th and 6th year. How we will calculate that? This is the 6th year. What we will do? Formula is basically P plus B, B for the balance amount, divided by C. P is the payback year, previous payback year. In 6th year, we are going to receive complete payment. So, which is the previous year? 5th ho jayega. When there is 6th year, it is the final year in which we are going to receive the amount. So, previous year to 6th year would be 5th year. P plus B. B is the balance amount. How we will get to know about it? Balance would be deducting 29,578 from 29,813 divided by the cash flow which we are going to receive. So this is the final thing which we calculated, that we are going to receive our complete investment of 3 lakh rupees within a period of 5.99 years, right? So this is how we can calculate these things. Now, what is the managerial accountant's role in this whole scenario? Managerial accountants are often asked to predict cash flows relating to operating cost savings, additional working capital requirements, and incremental cost and revenues. When cash flow projections are very uncertain, the accountant may increase the hurdle rate, which is the R, and use the sensitivity analysis. There can be a post-audit as a follow-up after the project has been approved to see whether or not expected results are actually realized. This is something very important which usually companies miss. And this is something which is very important to complete the feedback loop, right? You need to have, companies need to have this post audit as a follow-up thing after the project is completed. So now we will be talking about financial analysis and decision making with respect to choice of projects or capital expenditure. We all know that capital expenditure refers to funds that are used by a company for the purchase, improvement, or maintenance of long-term assets to improve the efficiency or capacity of the company. Long-term assets are usually physical, fixed, and non-consumable, such as property, equipment, or infrastructure, and that have a useful life of more than one accounting period. We discussed all this yesterday only. Also known as CapEx or capital expense, capital expenditures include the purchase of items such as new equipment, machinery, land, plant, building or warehouses, furniture and fixtures, business vehicles, softwares or intangible assets such as patents and licenses. There are various types of capital expenditures. They are normally bifurcated into two categories: expenses for the maintenance of levels of operation present within the company, and expenses that will enable an increase in future growth. A capital expenditure can either be tangible, such as machine, or intangible, such as a patent. But both intangible and tangible capital expenditures are usually considered assets since they can be sold when there is a need. It is important to note that funds spent on repair or in conducting continuing normal maintenance of assets is not considered capital expenditure and should be expensed on the income statement whenever it is incurred, because these are revenue, these are regular expenses. Now, what is the importance of capital expenditure? Why we are talking about this? Why we are conducting this MDP? Why you people are attending this? Because decisions how much to invest in capital expenditure can often be extremely vital decision made by an organization. They are important because of the following reasons: because they have long-term effect, because once you have bought a machinery, it is not that easy for you to sell it off again. Irreversibility: once you have made a big decision, once you have spent that money, so even if you are going to resell that asset, you are going to get amount according to a second-hand asset. You know, it is going to be a second-hand sale. So you are not going to get back on at the price at which you bought that. So definitely there is some loss whenever you want to replace a capital expenditure. High initial cost, definitely yes. And then yes, associated depreciation. If you have used that particular asset for some period of time, if you have used it for 1 year or for 2 years, then definitely there is even more reduction in the value as compared to the physical depreciation in the machinery or that particular asset. So because considering all these factors, because they have very long-term effect, they actually affect the organization financially, physically, emotionally. So these decisions needs to be taken care of, and they must be taken with due diligence and due research. Techniques of assessing some standalone risk are sensitivity analysis, break-even analysis, and simulation analysis. In sensitivity analysis, companies usually check, this can be done through spreadsheet as well. They check one by one. They check if we change this particular one element in the, say, balance sheet or in, say, cash flow, what is going to be the change. And in break-even analysis, we check how, what should be the price of your product if you want to break even, if you want to have your cost equal to the revenues, or you want to have at least that much revenues which are equal to your cost. In simulation analysis, it is basically a software generated process altogether, and where we check the validity and long-term effects of the projects from the financial perspectives, how those particular to invest in that particular asset, how much reserves we are going to use, what are the surpluses which are going to be used, and what are the available opportunities where we could have used all those funds. So these are the different techniques. And yes, the bottom line, the final thing of this entire session for the managers, for the financial managers, is that measures needs to be taken to reduce the variability or dispersion of income. measures can be adopted to prevent profit from falling below some minimum level. Measures can be adopted to increase the firm's ability to withstand unfavorable economic outcomes. Use of linear programming models. You know, companies need to shift from the regular traditional methods of calculating things to handle high number of projects and planning horizons for maximizing NPV. We can use combination of methods and then decide. And yes, agency problem has to be taken care of. Project management, efficient project management is very important. Post-project appraisal, post-audit, which we were talking about, must be done. An NPV of the entire portfolio to be estimated. It should not be that when we are considering only one project at a time, then we will be calculating the NPV of that particular project only. We need to calculate the portfolio. We need to calculate the NPV of the entire portfolio. How NPV of that entire portfolio is going to change after the inclusion of this particular new project. You understand that? We need to calculate the NPV of the entire portfolio. What would be the new NPV after we include one or two new projects? So this was all from my side. If any questions are there, we can check them out.
Much, ma'am. I'll ask participants to write down their questions in the chat box. We are done with the session. Now the session is open for any query that you want to ask. If you have any question, I don't see anything being written on the chat box. You can also raise your hand if you want to interact, if you want to personally ask a question. I'll enter and allow you in the room. No question, ma'am. All right. Thank you so much, ma'am, for in-depth insights into practical implications of capital budgeting. I'm sure it will assist us in taking important decisions related to investment at our work front. Thank you so much, ma'am. Yes. So that brings us to the end of the session. And I hope in two days of MD was fruitful to everyone. And we have learned number of techniques related to the investment decisions and how they can be incorporated basically into our work life on daily basis, how we are going to basically evaluate various investment decisions, how we can compare the alternatives. Okay, thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vikas,
thank you, ma'am,
for your valuable time. So we close the session as we do not see any question. So thank you, all the participants.